Hey everybody, Brad Geiger again with another webcomics.com vidcast, video podcast. All right, listen, it turns out, according to the members on webcomics.com, that this was, the last one was actually pretty good, and you'd like to see more. So, first things first, we got to come up with a name for this thing, because I don't know what to call it. So, if you have any ideas, please hit the comments and let me know, because I'm tripping all over myself coming up with a name for this thing. So item number two, let's get to some mail. Last time we talked about a couple things, but one of them was burnout. And I got a letter. Old man Geiger got a letter. I got an email, and I want to share it with you because it's actually pretty interesting. It starts like this. A forum topic you posted some time ago about failure versus growth helped me reframe my feelings about my work. I began to develop a new perspective and essentially let myself off the hook. Then I took a long break from drawing, nearly 6 months. That's something we talked about last time. Letting yourself recharge creatively sometimes takes more than a couple months. Sometimes it takes a while. I started back drawing again about a month ago since I had written during the downtime, but quickly bogged down into dread. So I signed up for an online drawing class, enjoyed it briefly, and then lost interest. Then it hit me like a ton of bricks. My passion is, and always has been, in the writing. Drawing for me is not a relaxing or enjoyable process. My chances of ever making any kind of profit from webcomics is, well, I'd be better off playing the lottery. So if I'm gonna make webcomics, I'd better be enjoying the process, right? My chances of making money off novels I will publish are slim to start, maybe better once I get cranking, but the kicker is I'm going to write no matter what because I enjoy it. Right? I have to write. It's one of the few things that I'm passionate about. My God, it's a freaking no-brainer. I'm a writer. Yeah. Wow. Number one, I'm going to guess that about half the people doing webcomics right now are in your shoes. They're trying to do art, and being a cartoonist is no easy task. It's a Herculean task. You've got to be a good writer, and you've got to be a pretty good artist. Now, I say pretty good because in most comics, at least humor comics, the art isn't as important as the writing. Of course, once we get into superhero comics, drama comics, stuff like that, the art becomes more and more important. But you've got to at least have a certain amount of ability for both. Most of the people that I see doing webcomics right now, to be honest with you, are pretty good artists, horrible writers, terrible writers. And the reason that they're bad writers is they don't take the time to edit. And we can do an entire show about that. But I'm going to get to a couple emails here first today and remind me, we'll catch up with that. 90% of writing is editing. If only you'd take the time to do it. You guys are writing this stuff. You can tell when you read it. If you know what you're looking for, if you've been doing this as long as I have, you can tell when somebody wrote something, didn't give it any edits, didn't give it any passes, and just threw it up there. It's horrible. Okay? So most of the people I see on webcomics right now, they're pretty good artists, horrible writers. You guys need to be collaborating with other people who have strengths that you don't have. You've got to take a good, long, hard look at your work and realize that, you know, some of these strengths, if you've been doing it for a while, you can obviously get better, but you may not ever get as good as you're going to need to be to make this something that you can really be proud of. At some point, you've got to admit your limitations and start doing some sensible things to compensate for that. And that may mean collaboration. It may mean, like this writer, this person who wrote in, says that she realized she's not a cartoonist. She's a writer. That's okay. That's wonderful. Okay? So congratulations on your self-discovery. I hope you decide to stay with webcomics.com. But if not, I'm thrilled that you had that little self-discovery. There's a lot of people out there cranking away at webcomics, not realizing why they're not getting any further than they're getting. And I hope their moment of self-discovery comes as well. Okay? But congratulations. I'm glad to hear I was able to help. Now, here's email number two. I was just thinking that it was interesting to hear you repeatedly say in the last vidcast, but you guys got to help me with a name. This is horrible. Maybe the next thing isn't a comic. I said that a couple times last episode. Maybe the next thing isn't a comic. And you say in this email, I think passion is the key. And you see people in fields all the time who build a following purely because of their passion and personality. I've heard a lot of cases where the successful project of artists are when they decompressed, goofed off, and came up with something fun and different with no real agenda behind it. By the way, if you guys don't know this already, that's the story of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. That was started as a complete joke. They were making fun of the trends of superhero comics at the time. It was totally meant to be a put down. and take a look at where it is now. Back to his email. Could you maybe speak to that? That whole idea of the success comes when you decompress and kind of get loose. Could you speak to that? And also how to balance a strong work ethic with that off-the-cuff, spontaneous attitude? Here's what's interesting. So in the, and thank you for your email. So in the first step, you say that the real success comes when you get, let me phrase that a little bit differently. So what you say is it's hard to make something successful when you're kind of pounding it out like it's a factory job and everything is processed and overthought and you're trying to game the system and so on and so forth. And you say that, you know, some of these great projects came when people got loose, when people decided that they wanted to decompress. And your first thought is, and this is really what your question is, how do I quantify that so that I can turn it into a factory pre-pro? Do you see what I'm saying? You're taking something that's very, very organic, and you're saying the problem with my comic is it doesn't have this organic thing. It's this other thing. It's pre-formatted. It's factory done. How can I take that organic thing and make it into a factory thing? Well, you can't. I can't tell you how to loosen up. I can't tell you how to be organic. I can't tell you how to have more fun doing your comic. If you don't know how to do that, there may be a bigger problem there. I don't know how else to answer that question. How do you have fun doing a comic? I don't know how I not have fun doing a comic. I don't know how I'm not loose doing a comic, because doing a comic is something that's very natural for me. It's something that's an organic thing that comes out of the creative process. I look forward to the time that I get to be creative every day. I look forward to that. That's something that feeds a real need for me. And yeah, there's a lot of work to it. There's the part after the creativity where you have to sit down. Like if you're me, you've got to sit down. Okay, now I've got to draw this image in perspective. I've got to make sure that these people's, you know, their anatomy is right and so on and so forth. And that part gets into a little bit of work. There's no getting around that. Anybody that's ever had to draw some of these detailed perspective images will tell you that. That's certainly not loose. That certainly isn't organic. But the creative process, I can't tell you how to enjoy comics more. Boy, that sounds depressing. It sounds like I'm putting you down, and it might just be that I'm not understanding the question right. If I were to give you 10 steps towards being more loose, I guarantee you they'd be horrible, because you can't quantify something that is unquantifiable. I don't know how else to answer that. And in fact, in so doing, you would ruin it. It's one of those things that if I gave you steps towards being, if I gave you a tutorial on how to be loose, if you followed that, it would for sure be a Frankenstein kind of looseness. It wouldn't be actual creativity. So I'm not sure I answered your question, but it was very interesting to me that I think you got the right idea. I think the takeaway to that is to allow yourself to be more loose, to allow yourself to be silly, to be, you know, the takeaway there is that you shouldn't try to process creativity. In other words, I think a lot of times some of us try to do comics that we think will be popular. I want to do a comic, so I'm going to do it about video games because Penny Arcade is popular. That describes the entire webcomic scene of the early 2000s, right? Everybody wanted to do a video game comic because Penny Arcade and PvP were so freaking popular. And they found out that their hearts weren't in it and their stuff stunk, right? We all know it. So if there's any takeaway from what you said, I think what it is to give yourself the leeway, to give yourself the creative freedom to do an unpopular comic. And I think if you put the quality into it, and if you put the passion into it, that unpopular comic could be the most popular thing on the web because of the passion, because it's a high quality comic. I don't think you can game the system. I don't think you can take a look at demographics and say, well, if I do a comic that has one talking duck in it and a robot and I set it in the city of Seattle, demographics show that I'll have a 63% success. You know, those kind of comics stink. The comics that are amazing, take a look at Kate Beaton. She does a comic, or did a comic that put her on the scene about history. Well, you know, who cared before she started doing it? And there's tons, XKCD, all of these that we always talked about on webcomics.com. I don't think you can game the system. I think you should allow yourself to be more and more creative and more silly and take the risk of being unpopular, of doing a comic that's purposefully unpopular, because you might just find that the passion that you find in doing it because you're the one that really thinks that this is great, that passion always shines through. So that may be the best takeaway out of all of this. Third email for today. Here's the question. I know that my work life has gotten busier over the years, so that anything that resembles a podcast format works perfectly for my commute. Ah, that's great to hear. I have a question for your next update. I know Patreon is the way forward with regard to earning money with webcomics. What kind of rewards do you notice patrons find more desirable? Is it a connection to the creator, exclusive content, or perhaps physical rewards like a blank of the month club? Well, I'll be honest with you. When I read this question, it made me decide that I was going to do more of these video podcast, vidcast things, whatever thing that you guys come up that we're going to name this. When I read this question, I realized I needed to do more of this because I have written maybe 10,000 words on webcomics.com about the topic of Patreon, and about what rewards work. I've covered this topic over and in subsequent posts we've talked about this, and just in how you phrase the question, I'm seeing that the posts aren't working. All right, so maybe this is gonna work. I've written about this a lot. Okay, so here's And sorry, this is why I'm never going to read your name, because I don't ever want somebody to feel like I'm picking on them. You can be, if I do this to you, you'll know that I'll never, ever make you feel horrible and point you out. Here's how I know you're not reading my posts. Is it perhaps a physical reward like a blank of the month club? The answer is you never process physical rewards on Patreon. Never, ever you don't do it. And I'll tell you why. And I've seen a lot of, I'm connected with a lot of web cartoonists on Facebook. And I saw this guy not too long ago saying, I read a lot of stuff that says you're not supposed to do physical rewards, but I do stickers and it feels really good because I'm putting something in the hands of my readers and blah, blah, blah. My first thought was, you want to feel proud about having readers with something in their hands. Do not say for work comics like I do. you can really shout from the rooftops. But here's the deal. Here's why you don't do physical rewards on Patreon. Number one, it's monthly. If you've ever done a Kickstarter, you know how tough it is to process and fulfill those rewards. And that's a one-time thing. It's Herculean. It's my word for the day, Herculean. Patreon, you're doing that shit every month. If it gets popular, you're going to spend all your time doing the Patreon rewards, and you're not going to be spending the time doing the art that brought people to your Patreon. Number two, you got to take a real hard look at the cost effectiveness of it. This guy that's on Facebook talking about doing stickers, I guarantee you if I sat down with him and we did an accounting of this, if we did a cost-benefit analysis, how much money is he putting into producing the stickers? How much time is he putting, because time is money, how much time is he putting into producing those stickers? How much shipping to get the stickers, or is he printing them off his Epson or printer, and if in which case, come on, is that really a reward? And how much time is he doing getting all that stuff packaged up, stamps, that costs money, I know it doesn't sound like much, but it all adds up, buddy. And it's all going to take away from that amount of money that people are supposed to be pledging to you doing more art. If you do a cost-benefit analysis and really count all the costs, and be honest with yourself, you'll see that doing physical rewards on Patreon is a loser move. Now, here's your gotcha moment. I'll say it for you. But Brad, you do exactly what you're telling us not to do. Yeah, you're right. And I wouldn't necessarily recommend it. But I will say this about that. Number one, I do offer a physical reward. It's at the $20 level, and you have to make 3 consecutive $20 pledges before you get the reward. That spaces out. I'm not spending nearly the amount of time, and I don't give up that physical reward until people are paying at a very high level. That's basically $60, and it's commensurate with what I used to sell my original art for, and that's the reward, is original art. It's commensurate with what I used to sell it for, and for $60 and getting somebody into a subscription kind of thing where they're putting up the money every month, many of those people, my $20 reward, I just did a quick accounting of it just for my own benefit. There's some people that are supporting me on Patreon that's cumulative since the day they've started, and there's 3 of them that have cumulatively reached over $400 a piece. There's another 3 that have crossed the $300 line. Before Patreon, I would have never gotten $400 out of each of those people. It wouldn't have happened, okay? And the rest of them are well over $100, a couple hundred dollars. I will do a physical reward for that, okay? You can bet your bottom dollar I am not doing a physical reward for a $5 pledge. I'm just not. Dude, I got too much to do. And if you were really minding your business, you'd realize you've got too much to do too, okay? So you don't do a physical reward on Patreon with an asterisk, unless it's at a high level. Unless you're really pulling in the money, then you can do that physical reward. Then I'll allow it. But if you're sending stickers to people, really, honestly, yeah, you want readers with something in their hands, you do not say for work. So physical rewards are out. Is it the connection to the creator? Listen. I'd love to think that people are signing on to my Patreon because I'm such a sparkling personality, they want to feel a connection to me. I'd love to believe that. No one's paying money to be connected to me, okay? Sorry, I don't think it's happening, all right? Maybe a buck or two. Maybe I'm a little bit sparkling. But by and large, enough to pay the mortgage? If you take one thing away from this vidcast podcast thing, it's this, and that is Patreon is not a tip jar. I know you've been told a tip jar. Listen, we say a lot of things. We used to tell people back in the day that webcomics were free. It wasn't free. It was ad-supported, but nobody signed that. And saying that never really got anybody excited. Free webcomics, that got people excited. Patreon is not a tip jar, even though that's how it's been parsed to you by an awful lot of people. It's not. Sorry. Patreon is a subscription service. You are getting people to subscribe to something. So all of those rewards, take a look at your own Patreon page right now. Oh, and by the way, you can change your rewards. If you're making a mistake, you can change it. You are not locked in. Just make sure you drop a line to the patrons that you do have and give them a heads up so that they can cancel their rewards, or cancel their pledges before the next payment period. That's fair. And by the way, if you're making a mistake and this new pledge is fixing the mistake, then if you lose a couple, feel confident in the fact that you'll gain them back. So take a look at your Patreon page right now. If you are offering anything that isn't a subscription content, exclusive content that people are willing to subscribe to. Now, at the $1 level, of course, everybody gives live chats and all this stuff away. That's fine. $1, that's fine. But when we're talking at the $5 and the $10 level, and $10 I've found to be the sweet spot, at the $5 and $10 levels, you need to be offering exclusive content. And I think it's, if it's any good, I think it's a $10 thing. Your $1 and $5 levels are good things to things that you don't have to think about, that just come naturally out of your creative process. These are sketches. These are early releases of the comics, stuff like this. That's good at the $1 and $5 level. But to really start to make money on Patreon, you have to find, you have to offer exclusive content and make it available to them on a subscription basis. This is what they're signing up for. They're not signing up. They for $1 and $5, you might get a few people who say, "Yeah, I'll throw him $5 to get that early comic because I like him." But that's not going to get you very far. If you want to really generate the income on Patreon, you have to look at it as a subscription service. All right, now there's a lot of good things about that. Number one, subscription services work awesome because what happens is people tend to subscribe and then forget about the subscription. And by the time they finally do cancel, they've paid more money than they thought they would have. That sounds kind of cynical. But from a business standpoint, that's why Hulu is subscription. That's why Netflix is subscription. Because once you get used to that money leaving your account every month, it becomes almost easier to leave it there than it does to go through the process of canceling it. You know that as a consumer. I guarantee you've been in that same situation. It took me months to cancel Hulu. I hated Hulu. All right, I should not be paying a subscription for something and have ads. I'm sorry. And yeah, I know. I'm still complaining about the fact that my cable TV has ads. I'm an old man is what I'm trying to tell you. But I went for months on Hulu, hating it, before I finally got around to canceling it. They got way more of my money than they should have gotten. Well, here's your chance to be on the other side of that. Now, how do you make this work? Do you have to do not safe for work content? No. Here's what you got to do. You've got to find the thing that your readers are willing to pay for. Simple as that. And it might be not safe for work. I got to be honest with you. I see a lot of people trying not safe for work because they think that it's easy. It ain't easy. You got to be able to, number one, you got to be able to draw your ass off pun intended, if you want to do not safe for work stuff. You're going to be a hell of an artist. Nobody wants to look at sloppily drawn not safe for work. Number two, you've got to bring a little something extra to the table when it comes to writing these stories, because they get boring real fast. I've got a renewed respect for people who work in adult comics. So is it not safe for work for you? No, and you might not have what it takes to pull that off, okay? Be honest with yourself where your strengths lie. You might not be that person. That's okay. But you do have to find what it is that your readers are willing to pay for. I went through a lot of stuff before I landed on this. I offered an all-ages comic that was completely off to the side of the Evil Inc. universe, based on my kids. Nobody cared. I offered Courting Disaster in its PG-13 version. I offered bonus comics, just single panel comics that I was doing. I thought were really, nobody cared. Okay. For me, for you, it's going to be different. So you've got to allow yourself the trial and error process. You've got to throw stuff up there, see what works, and find what your readers are willing to pay for. Because Patreon is, say it with me, not a tip jar. It's a subscription service. That's how you make money on Patreon. You got to find the rewards that your people are willing to pay for, and then make those rewards exclusive. Exclusive? You're not going to pay if it's not exclusive, right? And although I'm sure we'd all love to think that just offering some kind of emotional connection to us is something people are willing to pay for, they ain't going to do it either. So stay away from the, you can offer that stuff at the $1 and the $5 level. That's fine. The have a chat with me on Google Hangouts. I tried that. Nobody showed up. One or two people, you know, it was like they were paying for it. But then when I said, we're going to have a hangout. Nobody, it was crickets. I sat there and stared into the screen. And by the way, there's nothing more disheartening than offering a hangout that nobody shows up for. It was a blow to my ego. I had to stop doing it. It was making me crazy. So yeah, if you want to offer that stuff at the low levels, that's fine, $1 and $5, but that's not going to drive your Patreon to where you want it to be. And physical rewards, you're going to be running yourself ragged every month filling physical rewards. Before you offer a physical reward, do a cost-benefit analysis and realize that you may be a victim of your own success. What happens if that thing gets popular? This guy's doing stickers. What happens if he gets 100 people ordering stickers every month? Does he want to fulfill that? Come on. And it isn't scalable. He's not going to be making a lot of profit at 100 because his costs are going to go up at the same time his pledges go up. You need to find digital rewards. By the way, I'm doing a Kickstarter right now, fully one-third. And by the way, I'm not to brag, but just to put this into perspective, it funded within the first week. All right. Fully one third of my supporters on Kickstarter are getting nothing but digital rewards. Listen, you and me, we're doing digital stuff all the time. We don't give two thoughts about it. People value digital rewards a lot more than they used to. Okay. People want digital rewards. So how come you're not giving it to them? And it's a long list of things that we could be doing. Remember, digital rewards can be desktop backgrounds, mobile backgrounds, calendars that you put on your mobile background or your desktop. This can be ebooks. And if you've been doing this for any length of time, you've got an archive. Your archive is your greatest treasure when it comes to being a cartoonist. You should know this from the ad days. Your archive is great. You can go back in that archive and repackage stuff, package it in a different way. Here's all my best cat cartoons. Here's all my best dog cartoons. Put that stuff into an ebook, The Best of the Dog Cartoons, and you've got a reward people are going to enjoy. If you can come up with something like that every month, you're gangbusters, all right? Digital rewards has a wide there's a lot of what's the word I'm looking at? There's a wide amount of digital rewards that you can do. It's not just this month's comics. You can repackage, prepackage, redistribute, rearrange. There's all kinds of stuff that you can offer as a digital reward. Don't even think about physical until you've exhausted all of your digital rewards. okay? And always remember, I got to say it, your number one job before you even start thinking about a Patreon at all, making sure you're doing a high quality comic. You're doing a comic that's bringing people, putting butts in seats, as they said in vaudeville. Your first job, make sure you're doing a high quality comic. If you're not doing a good comic, if you're not delivering it every time you update, and I mean every time, and we can talk a lot about that, but if you're not doing a high quality comic, all this Patreon stuff is going to end for naught. If you're, okay, sorry truth time. If you are offering exclusive comics, if you're doing all of this and it's not working for you, the first thing you got to look at is maybe the comic's not good enough. That's not a bad thing. By the way, I sometimes feel like you guys are sitting there going, oh man, he's always saying we're horrible. No, here's the thing. I did a horrible comic for years, all right? The only way you get to do a good comic is by doing horrible comics and learning. Here's the problem. You can't be sitting there thinking, oh, all I got to do is do a crappy comic and sooner or later the quality just shows up like it's on order from UPS. You've got to do your horrible comic and look at it the next day and say, here's why it's not good, and then do better next time. There's some people out there. Scott hates it when we're at comic conventions doing a panel. I throw out that line, it's impossible to get worse at something you do every day, because he goes, I've seen a lot of people pull that off. And he's kind of got a point. Here's the thing. If you're doing your horrible comic, you're halfway on the road to success. This is a whole topic of itself. I may just cut this part out. If you're doing, the only way to do a good comic is to do a whole bunch of horrible comics and learn from them. There's a lot of people who are only doing half of that equation. So I'm going to wrap it up here, but here's that putting a little button on it. If your Patreon isn't where you think it is, and it probably isn't, your first stop isn't the rewards. It's, am I doing the comic that's going to make people want to support it? That's your first stop. And if not, you don't beat yourself up. You say, okay, now I know what I got to fix. All right? Now I know where the problem is. And the only way to a good comic is to do a whole bunch of horrible ones. Take it from a guy that did a whole bunch of horrible ones. Okay? I've been there. I go right. There's a lot about Greystone Inn that I'm very proud of. You buy a Greystone Inn, that big collection, there's a lot of good stuff there. But it's not at the level of quality that if I were to trot that out today, nobody's supporting that on Patreon. Nobody's supporting that on Kickstarter. It's great for what it was, for the time, for its place, and it got to me. It got me to where I am now, which is a pretty good cartoonist. I'm still on my way to being a good one, but I spent my time being a horrible one too. There's no shame in that. The only shame is if you never learn from your mistakes and progress up to the next level. That's the only shame. There's no shame in doing a horrible comic. The only way you get good is doing a whole bunch of horrible ones. All right? So that's the thought I'm going to leave you with. Thank you so much. Hit the comments. Let me know more questions, more topics you'd like me to cover. And for the love of God, somebody name this thing. So I can come up with a logo and I can stop tripping over my tongue. All right. Thank you. We'll see you next time.